hand those hands up to our God and worship Him this evening. Unto Him alone shall the gathering of His people be. We worship You, Father. We give You praise. We magnify Your name. You are worthy, and there is none like unto Thee. Be exalted, O Lord. Thank You, Father. Thank You. Thank You not just for what You do, but for who You are. We are grateful, O Lord, that we are here, and we bless Your holy name. Hallelujah. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. For in Jesus' mighty name we have worshipped. Let's be seated briefly. You're welcome to today's weekly healing school. And we have in our midst today our Rema Nigeria National Director. You know, I wanted us, for the sake of the people who are new in our midst, I'm talking about the healing technicians, as well as those who have joined the healing school today for the very first time. And we thought we should get him to, you know, come teach us today and speak to us generally before the end of the year. Just so you know, he was the one that started the Rema Healing School. Yes, he started it when Rema started. So he was the first healing school coordinator then. That was Pastor Tokes. Then he brought me in as assistant healing school coordinator. Then after that, of course, if you follow him at all, you know how busy his schedule is. So thank you very much, sir, for honoring our invitation. God bless you.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Dr. Chichi has certainly done such a phenomenal job with healing school. Let's just give her a good hand. She has. She has. She has.
Well, and just as we know, healing school has a threefold purpose. First, to teach God's word about divine healing. Second, to minister God's healing power to the sick. And third, to raise divine healing technicians.
Praise God. Well, today, I just in praying and seeking the Lord about what direction He'll have me go, I seemed to feel impressed in my heart to teach on how to overcome sickness and disease. How to overcome sickness and disease. And I want us to turn in our Bibles to Matthew chapter 4. And I read some verses there, Matthew chapter 4, from verse 1 through to 11. It says, "Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward and hungered. And when the tempter came to him, he said, 'If thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread.' But he answered and said, 'It is written, Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God.' Then the devil took him up into the holy city, and setteth him on a pinnacle of the temple, and saith unto him, 'If thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down, for it is written, He shall give His angels charge concerning thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest thou at any time thou dash thy foot against the stone.' Jesus said unto him, 'It is written again, Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God.' Verse 8, again the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain, and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them, and saith unto him, 'All these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me.' Then saith Jesus unto him, 'Get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve.' Then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him." Heavenly Father, we thank You because You're our Father, and You're a good Father. Thank You because the entrance of Your word gives light. It gives understanding to the simple. We approach Your word humbly and reverently this afternoon. We trust that by Your Spirit You will unveil, unfold, and reveal the word of God to our spirits. Thank You because Your healing power is made manifest. Sicknesses leave the bodies of people. Their minds are restored. We give You praise, Father, because we walk in absolute triumph over sickness and disease. In Jesus' name. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. So talking about how to overcome sickness and disease. Now, one thing we know is this. We know we live in a world where the devil is God. And He will bring tests. He will bring trials. He will bring challenges. 2 Corinthians 4:4 calls Satan the god of this world. He's the god of this world. Well, how did he become that? It's Grandpa, now Grandpa Adam Kosam. Adam sold out to the devil, and then Satan took hold of man's dominion, and he began a reign of tyranny over the human race. So sickness and disease, those things were not a part of God's original plan or a part of God's creation. John 10:10 says, "The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy." Jesus said, "I'm come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly." That which steals, which kills, which destroys is from the devil. So the devil is the thief. The devil is the thief. The devil is the thief. So sickness and disease, those things come from the devil. And as long as we're here, he will keep doing his very best to try to put sickness on us. Now, there are some people that already have sickness on them who are Christians. Listen, we'll get rid of that sickness. Amen. We'll tell you just how to do that in a bit. Amen. And in case he's trying to put sickness on you, he doesn't have to. And if he already has, you can get rid of it. So we need to know that. Now, the Bible says that Jesus left us an example that we should follow in his steps. The Bible says if we are in him, we are to walk as he walked. In this portion of scriptures where we read, we saw the account of when Jesus was tempted. Was Jesus tempted? Sure. Did Jesus feel like sinning? He must have, because the Bible says he was tempted. He was tempted, like as we are. And we see the account of the temptations, three of them. And we see how Jesus overcame those temptations. Now, whether it's a temptation to sin, or it's a temptation to be sick, or it's a temptation to lack, the same principles are the same. And the same way Jesus overcame the devil on these three counts, that's the same way we had overcome sickness and we had overcome disease. Now, three things really that we can bring out from what Jesus did. Number one, build the word of God into your spirit. Build the word of God into your spirit. Now, you notice that when the devil came, brought the first temptation, Jesus immediately said, "It is written." How did Jesus know what was written? Because he studied it. So we need to know what is written. Amen. Now, what is written about sickness? What is written about healing? Isaiah 53, verses 4 and 5. The Bible says, "Surely he hath borne our griefs." That Hebrew word, griefs, literally means sicknesses or diseases. It says, "and carried our sorrows." That Hebrew word, sorrows, literally means pains. It says, "yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes we are healed." Matthew 8:17 says, "that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses." 1 Peter 2:24, "who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed." You see, 1 Peter 2:24 is not a promise. It's a statement of fact. God did not promise to heal you. He already did. He healed us 2,000 years ago through the finished work of redemption. By those stripes that were laid upon Jesus, healing was granted to us. So we need to build the word of God into our heart. Amen. See, God's word, the written word of God, is full of power. It's full of power. You know, many times you're looking for the mighty man of faith and power, the anointed man of God. If only I could be in a meeting where the power of God was. If only I knew one man that was anointed. Let me tell you something. No matter how anointed anybody is, he's not as anointed as the word of God. All of God's power is in his word. All of God's ability is in his word. Anything the word of God cannot do, God cannot do it. Because God is one with his word. And no such thing exists anywhere. Hebrews 4:12 says, "for the word of God is quick." That word "quick" is the word zao, living and powerful. The word powerful is the word energia, from where you have energy. It's full of power, full of God's energy, full of divine power, God's ability to drive out sickness, to drive out disease, to bring to pass whatever it provides. The word of God is living and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow. Says, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. So God's word is living. It's living. It's living. It's living. It's not just ink on paper. It's alive. It's alive. John 6:63. The Bible says, it's the spirit that quickeneth. The flesh profits nothing. The words I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. So God's word is spirit. God's word is life. God's word is full of God's substance. God's word is full of God's ability. It's impregnated with power. It's anointed. I like to put it like this. It's Holy Ghost-rated. Amen. Given by the Spirit of God. See, in Psalm 107 verse 20, the Bible says he sent his word and healed them and delivered them from their destructions. Fenton's translation of that says he sent his word and it healed. Amen. See, the word is the healer today. Full of healing power. Full of healing ability. Proverbs 4:20-22. My son, attend to my words. Incline thine ear unto my sayings. Let them, that is my words, not depart from thine eyes. Keep them, my words, in the midst of thine heart. Said, for they are life unto those that find them. And they are health to all their flesh. Now that word health is the Hebrew word mapi. Mapi means medicine. God's word contains God's ability. Contains God's power. There was one particular lady. She was born with one leg shorter than the other. So as she grew, it became much shorter. About 6 inches shorter than the other. And then that leg had only 3.5 toes. Instead of 5. She was born like that. Then she got a hold of one series by Brother Hagin, Faith Classics. Faith Classics has 6 messages in it. 6 big hindrances to faith. You can have what you say. Actions that correspond with faith. You know, 6 messages in that series. She got a hold of that series. It was when it was real to real. And then she began playing those messages. She said the first time she heard it meant nothing to her. She didn't even understand. But she kept playing. She kept playing it. She kept playing it. She kept playing it. She kept playing it. Said, after 1 month, nothing happened. 2 months, nothing happened. 3 months, nothing happened. 4 months, nothing happened. 5 months. Lo and behold, the short leg started growing by itself. And guess what? It grew to the same size. The 1.5 toes, this is a grown adult. They grew out by themselves. Did anybody pray for her? No. God's word got into it. There was somebody who came to Rema, USA one time. Also had one leg shorter than the other. Within a 2-year period of being in class, both legs grew to the same length. Yeah, God's word did it. It's full of power. It's full of power. It's full of power. It's full of power. Full of healing power. Full of creative power. I was ministering one time. This was in OAU. The person involved is a pastor today. And many years ago, this was 1996. A grown adult, he had a tooth was gone from his mouth. And I was led to minister to him. And you know, it grew out. grown adult. You don't grow teeth after a certain age. But I guess the power of God didn't know that. Amen. Whoa, glory to God. Creative ability is in God's word. Healing power is in God's word. Replaced organs can be put there. Defective organs can be replaced. Why? Because there's power in the word of God. There's power in the word of God. God's ability is in his word. So let's build the word of God into our spirit. That's my first point. So when the devil came, Jesus told the devil, it is written. Then the devil came with another temptation. And then Jesus knew what was written about that temptation. You notice he didn't go to search it. He just set it off right away. Which meant that he had it inside him. So let's build the word of God into our spirits. Let me tell you something. If you are not sick now, The devil, sometimes in the future, will try to make you sick. If he's not trying already. You see, there are some subjects you can't afford not to feed on constantly. P.C. Nelson told Brother Hagin, he said, constantly feed along the lines of faith and healing. He said, because the day will come when you will either need faith for your own healing or for the healing of a loved one. And if your faith has not been fed in that area, you'll be at a disadvantage. Smith Wigglesworth said, if you wait until you need faith and then try to get it, you waited too late. F.F. Bosworth said, most Christians feed their bodies 3 hot meals a day, their spirits 1 cold snack a week, and then they wonder why they're so weak in faith. Build the word into your heart. Yes, I believe in manifestations of the Holy Ghost. We're open to them. And in actual fact, I found out that when you exalt the word, you have more manifestations of the Spirit. I have manifestations of the Spirit in a rather consistent basis. But let me tell you something. Whether the Holy Ghost is in manifestation or the Holy Ghost is not in manifestation, I can get the sick healed. I know how by the word of God. Amen. You know, sometimes people talk about the anointing and the atmosphere. Listen, no matter the atmosphere, no matter how difficult the atmosphere is, I will create my atmosphere. Yes, because words create atmospheres. I learned to do that with God's word. Amen. God's word, build it into your heart. Find scriptures about healing and meditate on them. What does it mean to meditate? Read, actively read. Think upon. Mutter. Say them over and 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 over to yourself. Isaiah 53, 4 and 5. Matthew 8, 17. 1 Peter 2, 24. And that's an excellent combination. The Bible says in the mouth of 2 or 3 witnesses, let every word be established. Now, if you want to count Isaiah and Matthew as one witness, because Matthew was quoting Isaiah, then it's 2 witnesses. Now, if you want to count Isaiah, Matthew, and Peter as 3 separate witnesses, then that's 3 witnesses. So that's actually 2 or 3 witnesses. So it just fits the bill. It establishes the fact that healing is God's will for us because it is in the redemptive plan. It's just as easy to get healed as it is to get saved. It's just as easy to get healed as it is to receive forgiveness of sins. Because the same redemptive plan that dealt with the sin problem dealt with the sickness problem. You know, let's say you got cancer. Do you think God needs to do some push-ups? You know, and then Michael says, Jehovah God, Father God, what are you doing? Says, is that person? It's cancer they have. I need to do some push-ups so I'll be strong enough to be able to heal them. You know, I think God needs to go to the gym. He doesn't. He doesn't. He is the self-existing one. He's the Almighty God. Amen. Build the word of God into your spirit. You know, some people are careless here. You know, you sit down, you've got terminal sickness in front of you, and you sit down with Africa magic from morning to night. We know what you're trying to do. You're trying to die. Don't be stupid. Don't be stupid. Your life is on the line. Fight. Fight. There are some people's numbers you need to block on your phone. There are some churches you need to stop attending. Where they tell you that God uses sickness to teach people a lesson. If you go there, you will die young. That's a fact. There's some friends you need to cut away from. It's your life that is on the line. Don't do your life like kites. You know, you do your life to play kites. Don't do that. Surround yourself with the word of God. Let it play 24/7. Get it by your bedside. Get it in your car. Get it everywhere. Get around the word. Build it into your heart. Build it into your heart. Build it into your heart. You know, you see some people, they are faced with a challenge. You see, yeah, that guy is going to pull through. He obviously will. You can tell. You see some other people, you say, that guy, we're not sure. He just may die. And God is good. It doesn't mean God wanted him dead. But you see, God is not going to violate your will. God is not going to force himself on you. He won't. He won't. His word works. If we will dare to act on it. And you see, you can carry a bona fide baby Christian in your faith. When people have been exposed to God's word, God expects more from them. You know, there's some, I've heard stories about how there was this pastor, and they say everybody prayed, and the man still died. And people are wondering, why did he die? And someone comes and says, well, God works in mysterious ways, his wonders to perform. You see, the man had been exposed to God's word. All your praying will not get him healed. He has to take his healing by himself, by acting on God's word. And if he doesn't do it, he will die. And the gospel will continue. That's a fact. And somebody will say, wouldn't that hurt the healing ministry? No. Do you get my point? The word of God is true, regardless of who received or who did not receive. If healing is true, so and so won't have died. Look, let me ask you a question. Is the new birth true? Is everybody saved? Does that make the new birth not true? Regardless of who received or who didn't receive, the Bible is still so. So build the word of God into your spirit. Go into the Bible for yourself. Yeah, it's good to listen to tapes, but that's secondary. Listen to messages, that's secondary. Primarily, get into the Bible for yourself. Open the Bible. Let it not depart from your eyes. So read it. And then let it paint a picture on the inside of you. Then get good messages, teaching messages, books, videos, audios, whatever, on healing, and keep feeding on them. Build the word of God into your heart. So that's the first thing. And now, don't wait until you're sick to do that. Do it constantly. There's no day under God's heaven that I don't spend at least 1 hour studying on the subjects of faith and healing. Now, those are not the only subjects I study. I read the Bible every day. On other subjects, because God doesn't want me to be a lopsided kwashoko or beriberi Christian that is deficient in one area. So we need to feed on the entire counsel of God's word. But there are some things, whether you know them or you don't know them, they don't matter much. Who is the Antichrist? We'll find out. Who was taller between Abraham and Sarah? When I get to heaven, I will ask them, or I will tell them to back each other, and I will find out who is taller. How broad was David's chest? I'll get a prue. I will measure it. You know, some of those things are not that important. Whether you know them or you don't know them, they won't stop them you from going to heaven. But there are some things that if you don't know them, well, you may go to heaven, but you may go there earlier than you should have. Do you get my point? Yeah. Build the word into your spirit. That's the first thing. Jesus obviously did that. That's why no matter what area the devil came at him, he knew the appropriate scripture. The devil tried to twist scripture out of his context. Tell him that he said he will give his angels charge over you. The devil was quoting Psalm 91, verse 11 for Jesus. Jesus laughed. That's scripture taken out of context. So when I say build the word of God, I'm talking about the rightly divided word of God. I'm talking about getting understanding of that word, which will come through study, which will come through meditation. Build it on the inside of you. Don't let anybody call dog monkey. You know? They will call dog monkey for you. Know God for yourself. Know the Bible for yourself. Make it your word. Yeah. When you talk about Mark 11, 23 and 24, you talk about Kenneth Hagin. As if he wrote it. Yeah, he made it his own. You can make it your own too. You can make any verse of scripture your own. Actually, all of it is our own. It belongs to us. Amen. Second thing, number two. You notice that when the devil came at Jesus with the temptations. Now, it's possible they came as thoughts to his mind. It's possible the devil appeared to him physically and said it to him. Whichever way it came, you know, is not as important as the fact that it came. And how did Jesus respond? Jesus said, you notice that, right? He said, Jesus didn't think. Jesus did not just say, man shall not live by bread alone. And then he was thinking in his mind. Man shall not live by bread alone. That wasn't how he overcame the devil. He spoke. If you will not speak, you will go under. You overcome with words. Revelation 12:11. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. The way we read that is like this. You know, so let's say it's time to give testimony. And then you say, they overcame by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of the testimony. Come and give testimony. Yeah, it's good to give testimonies. Some testimonies really are testifolies, but there are testimonies, and it's great. But that place is not talking about giving testimonies. The literal Greek actually says they overcame him because of the blood of the Lamb and by the logos of God that was on their lips. The word of God that was in their mouth. See, in Ephesians 6:17, the Bible says, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the rhema of God, which is the spoken word of God. See, there are times when there may be a scripture that stands out in your heart. As you meditate on scriptures about healing, one may just seem to stand out in your heart. Great. Or if one doesn't stand out, pick one. Amen. Just pick one that covers your case. And then speak it. Speak it. The spoken word of God. The spoken word of God. You know, there's a place of believing something in your heart and saying it. You know, I'm healed according to the word of God. That's scriptural to say. But you know, there's also the place of speaking to the mountain. Jesus said in Mark 11:23, for verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass. He shall have whatsoever he saith. So there's a place of saying, sickness, such and such, I stand against you. You have no place in this body. According to the word of God, I'm healed. I refuse to permit you here. This body is a temple of the Holy Ghost. Just keep speaking. Keep speaking. You know, that way you like to talk, right? You know, and some of us can talk for a living. And some of us actually do. Talk to stay alive. Talk. Keep talking. Keep talking. Keep talking. You say, what if I don't believe it? Still say it. Because even if you don't believe it, if you will say it long enough, those words will register on your spirit and they'll dominate your life. Romans 10:17 says, so then faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God. Proverbs 18, verse 20. A man's belly, which is his spirit, shall be satisfied with the fruit of his mouth. And with the increase of his lips shall he be filled. So, this mouth is not just for feeding his tummy. It's also for feeding my spirit. So, I can speak the word of God into my spirit, which is a part of meditation. But you see, also speak the word of God. Many times, a lot of the confessions we make about certain situations, usually when we start, the confession is affecting you more than it's affecting the problem. Many times, we're not yet in a place of full persuasion. So that's why it looks like the problem is not changing. It looks like the sickness is getting worse. It's okay. It's okay. Just like when Jesus cursed the fig tree, there was no visible change at the moment. At least from Mark's account of the story, no visible change at the moment. But his words went to the roots of the tree. And his words killed the roots. So it was a matter of time. The shoot was going to get dead too. So keep speaking. Speak the word of God in faith. Speak the word of God in faith. Speak the word of God in faith. As in say it. When you wake up in the morning, start talking. Start talking. You get inside the shower, be talking. Himself took my infirmities and bare my sicknesses. By the stripes of Jesus, I am healed. I stand against this sickness. I stand against this disease. God's word says, resist the devil and he will flee from you. Satan, you are the one behind this and I resist you. You are wearing your clothes, getting ready, say it again. You get inside the car, start saying it. You get to the office, you are the only one. As you are getting your office set, you are the only one who's there, say it again. The other people around, say it under your breath. A pain hits you, speak again. A thought comes to your mind. Oh, do you remember what the doctor said? Say it again. Just keep speaking, keep speaking, keep speaking. Keep the word of God in your mouth. Keep speaking, keep speaking. Romans 10:8, but what saith it? The word is nigh thee, in thy mouth and in thine heart. That is the word of faith which you preach. Deuteronomy 30:14. But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, in thy mouth and in thine heart, that thou mayest do it. Keep it in your mouth as well as your heart. Keep saying it. Keep saying it. He shall have whatsoever he saith. See, there was one time, Brother Hagin was in his 80s. He said his sugar level just rose. His BP rose. And he had some issues with his colon. Now, from time to time, the devil tried to put sickness on him. Well, what did he do? Just what he taught all of us to do. He just acted on God's word. So you know what he did? He said he picked Galatians 3:13 and Deuteronomy 28:61. And then he began to say it. According to Deuteronomy 28:61, high blood sugar, high blood pressure, colon problem, they are part of the curse of the law. But according to Galatians 3:13, Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I no longer have any of them. He said he kept saying that and saying that and saying that and saying that. He said he said it and said it and said it over and over every day. He kept saying it. Every time, remember, he'll say it. Every time you say it. And make sure you remember. If you don't remember, then you are not looking for healing. Amen. He went for his next checkup with the doctor. They couldn't find a trace of any of it. That all cleared. Are you listening? God's word works. So let's put it in our hearts and then let's speak it out of our mouths. If your faith will not move your mouth, it won't move your sickness. Yeah. If you keep silent, then you're going to lose by default. So don't be silent. Be talking, be talking, be talking, be talking. Every opportunity you get, speak the word. Every chance you get, speak the word. Every chance you get, speak the word. Just keep saying it. If you will hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, do that which is right in his sight. Give ear to his commandments. Keep all his statutes. I will permit none of these diseases upon thee. Exodus 15:26, which are permitted upon the Egyptians from the Lord that healeth thee. See, that's what his word says. Romans 8:11. But if the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his spirit that dwelleth in you. So just keep saying it. He dwells in me and he quickens my mortal body. All authority in heaven and in earth is vested in the name of Jesus. That name belongs to me. And in the name of Jesus, I stand my ground. I will not die. I will live. I'll declare the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. He said, with long life, he will satisfy me and show me salvation. Paul said, for to me to live is Christ, to die is gain. Said, I'm in a strait betwixt two, having a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better. Nevertheless, to abide in flesh more needful for you. Said, that which I shall choose, so it's my choice. It's my choice. It's my choice. When you die, it's your choice. It's your choice. It's your choice. It's your choice. You know, sometimes somebody will die, they'll say he answered his home call. I only know one person God called. Well, maybe more than one. God called Enoch. You know? Yeah, and he didn't die. It's not a home calling, it's a home going. God doesn't determine when you die, you do. You have more to do with how long you live than you imagine. The Bible doesn't say it's appointed unto man when to die. It says it's appointed unto man once to die. And after that, the judgment. Amen. So speak. Keep speaking the word. Keep speaking the word. Keep speaking the word. As you're dressing up, that pain hits you again. Says himself took my infirmities and bare my sicknesses. By the stripes of Jesus, I'm healed. Then somebody comes and asks you, oh, how far? How far? Hey, how is it going? How is it going? Say, I believe I am healed. If I say, what did he do? I say, I believe I am healed. What part of that don't you understand? Is it the I believe part or the I'm healed part? Yeah. You know, sometimes some people can come in the name of pitying you and they can kill you. You don't need pity. You need people. Yes, we need compassion, no doubt. But I'm talking about there's a way people can pity you until they kill you. Brother Hagin talked about one man who was ministering to him. Man was bedfast on a deathbed. He said, and he knew that what the man needed to do was to get out of that bed. So he told him, Spirit of God inspired him to tell that man to get up. His relations were there. He was like, they were pitying him. He can't get up. He said he had to get all of them out of the room. You want to kill him? If he doesn't act, he will die. The man got out of bed. It looked like he was going to die. The way the expression, as he took one step and took another, the power of God hit him. Wow! He started jumping all over the place. Healed by the power of God. Faith is an act. Faith is an act. If you really believe, you will act. So we said, number one, build the word of God into your spirit. Number two, speak the word of God in faith. Speak the word of God in faith. 2 Corinthians 4:13, we having the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believed, therefore have I spoken. We also believe and therefore speak. You see, you know, the thing about God's word is this. Sometimes we are looking for something new. I'm still thrilled with the old. Yeah, I'm not looking for, some people are so deep, they drown. These basics, we never outgrow them. Amen. There's no use looking for a new revelation where there isn't new revelation. You get into error. Now, the third thing, the third and the final, three of them I said I was going to say. The third is this, be persistent. Be persistent. Be persistent. 1 Peter 5:8-9, be sober, be vigilant. For your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. It says, whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. The American Standard Version says, whom resist steadfast in your faith. See, sometimes you need a steadfastness. See, sometimes the devil acts as if he has hearing problem. He doesn't. He heard you, and he heard you loud and clear. But he wants to see whether you really believe what you claim you believe. So when you start confessing, the symptoms may get worse. Or the symptoms may do like they are not even hearing you. Now you own you, they talk. The symptoms are still there. Nothing is changing. In fact, you go next to your next doctor's appointment and the report is worse. What do you do when that happens? Be persistent. Just be persistent. Resist him steadfast. You know what they call bulldog tenacity? If a bulldog bites somebody, the jaw will lock. It will lock. That piece of flesh is coming out. There's no go come about it because the jaw has locked. Are you listening? We need to have that kind of bulldog tenacity with God's word where you take a hold of it and it locks. See, when Pastor Hagin was young, his uncle, Uncle Pat, was playing it with him one day. And then he had his arm in a lock. And he told him, say, Uncle Pat, I won't let go of your hand. You know, he wasn't calling his uncle, uncle. You know, they were just kidding, playing around, playing rough. Like, you do in your own family too, right? Yeah, so they were just doing that. He said, call me uncle, or I won't let go of your arm. Pastor Hagin told him, say, you had better go ahead and break that arm now. And let's start going to the hospital. So that they can put it inside cast and everything. Because I am not saying uncle. Forget it. I will not say it. Break the arm. Go ahead. I'm not going to say it. As soon as he said that, his uncle said, oh, you are just like the rest of us. And let go of the arm immediately. That's the part that blessed me more. You see, there's that kind of tenacity we must have about God's word. Some people have, their backbone is like thread. You just push them. Lefu. You know, they fall like a pack of cats. No. As in, be resolute. Jesus told a man, he said, wilt thou be made whole? You see, you have to exercise your will for healing. And there's something about a resolute will. A resolute will. When you say no, this is what the word of God says. If I'm going under, this word is going under too. Sink or swim, live or die, come hell or high water, go over or under. The Bible says it, I believe it, and that settles it. I'll keep saying the same things. I'm not going to quit. Be persistent. Be persistent. Listen, you can't go under for going over. It's either you win or you win. The devil does like, he will do like he won't move. He's a lie. He's been defeated. The one who is behind that sickness, the one who is behind that disease, is the same one that Jesus brought to naught. He's the same one that Jesus paralyzed. He's the same one that Jesus disarmed. So all that thing he's doing now, bluff. Resist him steadfast. Stand your ground. Stand your ground. Ephesians 6:13-14. It says, and having done all to stand, stand therefore. Brother Hagin's mom had a breakdown. She had a nervous, mental, and a complete breakdown. And she had some issues. She got into depression. Brother Hagin was young then. The pastor couldn't help her. But then there was this doctor who said, when it comes to stuff with the nerves, said, I'll tell you what you can do. And he gave her that scripture. Having none to stand, stand therefore. He said, anytime that stuff is coming on you, and people who are battling depression, I'm talking to you. People who are battling all these things, I'm talking to you. Say, usually when that thing is going to start, you know. You start feeling it. It's the same thing when you are tempted to be sick. When your throat starts doing, when the first, you know, starts. When those that first symptom of the headache, imagine somebody is coming to your house and you don't want the person to stay. You know, it's easier to stop the person by the gate. Then you let the person enter through the gate, enter inside the house, go to the master's bedroom, and then remove your clothes from there, and then pack their clothes inside there, and then go to your bathroom, and then put all their stuff. You know, when you now want to chase them out, after they have unpacked, and they have put their food in their pantry, and they have put your stuff in the kitchen, and they have hung their clothes in your closet, it's a little more difficult. It's easier to stop them before they even get in. So when you start sensing that thing, the doctor told her, speak. Just start speaking to it. You know, that lady got healed and she stayed healed. Never had any more issues with that stuff. Be persistent. Hebrews 6:12. The Bible says, we are not to be slothful, but we are to be followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promise. When we think about patience, this is what we think about. You're just sitting down waiting for class to start. You're just sitting down waiting for class to finish. You just sit down waiting for healing school to end. You know, that's how we think of patience. That's not what that verse is talking about. It's really talking about persistence. It's talking about stick-to-itiveness. It's not passive. It's active. Active. You keep confessing the word. You keep thanking God for your healing. You keep standing your ground. You keep praising God. You keep feeding on the word. That's patience. It's active. So be persistent. Hebrews 10:35 and 36. The Bible says, cast not away your confidence, which has great recompense of reward. It says, for ye have need of patience, that after you have done the will of God, you might inherit the promises. You have need of persistence. So keep at it. You say, it's been 2 months now. I've been confessing God's word. I've been feeding on his word. My healing hasn't yet been fully manifested. What should I do? Keep at it. He's in 1 year now. I'm still battling some of those symptoms. What do I do? Keep at it. Hey, it's been a while now, and I'm feeling weary. Yeah, we all feel weary. But what do you do when you feel weary? You keep fighting. You say, but I'm feeling weary again. Then you keep fighting. The best time to fight is when you feel like quitting. Muhammad Ali will run around the stadium until he's tired. When he gets tired, then he will start counting. 1, 2. If he says, I went 20 times, it was 20 times after he got tired. Let's learn to build persistence, stamina on the inside of us. And let me tell you something. There's no temptation you can face that is not common to man. And God will not allow you to be tempted above what you are able. If you are facing that situation, God knows your capacity. And God knows you've got what it takes to surmount it. God knows you can overcome it. So what do? Overcome it. Stand your ground. Stand your ground. I haven't told us anything we really don't know. I've just stirred up our pure minds by way of remembrance. So we were looking at how to overcome sickness and disease. We said, number one, build the word of God into your spirit. And that happens through study, through meditation, scriptures about healing, and we gave a sampling. Then number two, we said this, speak the word of God in faith. So keep speaking the word of God. By the stripes of Jesus, I'm healed. Mr. Devil, I stand against you. You are not going to put this on me. Or if he already has, this stuff that you put here is not my property. Jesus took my infirmities. He bore my sicknesses. This one is not my own. It's your own. I reject it. I resist it. I refuse it. Have you ever seen somebody resist arrest? You know, they're trying to get the person. They say, I'm not going. Then they try to hold him. Then he starts fighting. Then they try to get him out of the door. Then he puts his leg. Then they try to remove his leg. Then he puts his neck. Then they try to put his neck. Then he fights the policeman. That's resisting. Oppose. To resist means to oppose vigorously. Amen. How about us? Let's all just stand up on our feet. Amen. And let's say this together. According to the word of God, I am healed. Healing belongs to me. Jesus took my infirmities. He bore my sicknesses. What he took, I did not take. What he bore, I need not bear. By his stripes, we were healed. And because we were, I was. And because I was, I am. Devil, listen up. Now you are the talk to. I stand against you with everything that is inside me. In the name of Jesus, on the grounds of the finished work of redemption, on the grounds of the shed blood of Jesus, you cannot put sickness on my body. You cannot put disease on my body. I'm not the sick trying to get healed. I am the healed walking in health. I stand my ground. I refuse to budge. I refuse to move. I refuse to shake. I am resolute. I am healed. Do you believe that? Praise him for it.
Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Let's be seated briefly. We are going to take good turnout, by the way. If you all come out like this, trust me, you won't be sick. If you come like this every day, or at least follow online, or you come every week, every Tuesday, you won't be. The devil is in trouble, major trouble. Praise God. So we will take our offering very briefly. The offering, of course, is not because you want healing or you've received healing. No, it's none of that. It's just to help run the school and, you know, other things. So we'll take if you want an envelope, you can raise your hands and they put an envelope in your hand and we'll take our offerings. Praise God. Let me round off with this story about Pastor Tooks. I remembered it because recently the devil came to put malaria on my body and I rejected and resisted him so badly. He packed his things and ran. So much so that I went back to the hospital to do a malaria test. They didn't see any malaria parasite anywhere. But let me tell you about Pastor Tooks a little bit. A story recently, sometime, I think, was it early this year or last year? He was they said he had appendicitis. Many of us know appendicitis. You know, and I mean, it looked like it was a really, really, really bad case and he needed surgery and all that. Please, I beg, you know how they put a caveat? Don't do if you haven't reached. You understand? You need to go to hospital, I beg, just go. Some people have been handling these truths for a very, very long time. Don't think because you just heard this small snippet today, then tomorrow everything is, please, do the one your faith can carry you through, I beg. So I'm putting a caveat now. Anyways, he was diagnosed. It was a very, very terrible case of appendicitis. Ideally, should have gone to hospital, should have gotten a surgery and all that. And then the person that diagnosed him was waiting. 1 week passed. He didn't hear that Pastor Tooks went to hospital. Didn't hear that he had a surgery. 2 weeks, 3 weeks and all that. And then guess what? Exactly what he said here was exactly what he did. And then the appendicitis left. He didn't need to go for any surgery. He didn't have any. He hasn't had any. The thing is scared to come back and will not come back. Are we understanding this? These things are truths. They are real, I'm telling you. So that's why sometimes it's good to hear those who have passed through it. See you next week, Tuesday, by the way. God bless you.